to you, yeah. And Lord, let me burn for you again. Let me return to you again. God, I'm running for your heart. I'm running for your heart. Tonight I'm a soul on fire. Lord, I'm longing for your way.
Day by day, you barely have the strength to pray in the valley low. And how hard your fight has been, how deep the pain within, wounds that no one else has seen, hurts too much to show. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. A little bit of scripture this morning before we get going. Just with the emails that are flying around about church and actually some of the song selections this morning, kind of got to dig in just a little bit. 2 Corinthians 12. It's interesting that how fragile life is and how much we think we're in control when we're actually not in control of hardly anything. And I was thinking kind of some of the funny examples of that is if a harmless garden snake was to go right down through the seats, how interesting and how fragile life would be and how many people would be flying out of their seats screaming. For me, it's yellow jackets, dude. I'm like ducking hard time. Or bats, I guess for that matter. Hate bats. But then something a little bit more serious, like a deer cleans out your car. That's a huge inconvenience, but we had no control over that. People go in the hospital. You have an extra bill that you weren't expecting that doesn't fit in the budget, and that just throws things for a loop. Or you get a diagnosis, something a little bit more serious, like you get a diagnosis, even if you have a family member or a friend that has doesn't have a good outlook or that type of thing. We've seen a few of those this week and in the past, I know, 6 months or so, that type of thing. And it's interesting, in 2 Corinthians 12, you see Paul kind of dealing with the same thing. He says, three times I pleaded for the Lord about this. How many times have we pleaded? Way more. I'm thinking only three. It seems like that would be a little more constant than that. But he says, three times I pleaded for the Lord about this so that it should leave me. But he said, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast in all the more gladness in my weakness. How counterculture is that? Because we're always trying to build and be strong so that the power of Christ may rest in me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weakness. That's not me. Insults, hardships, persecution, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong. That is truly deep spiritual maturity right there, huh? Because that is definitely not the way we feel. It's not the way we live most of the time. So just a little bit of a reminder for you guys, because we're going to sing a little bit about grace this morning. So just a good reminder. How dare I throw my Bible out down like that? Mm-mm-mm. Here we go.
Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's heart. You lead us by still waters and to mercy. And nothing can keep us apart. God, you woos the weak to lead the strong. You lead us in the song of your salvation, and all your people sing aloud. Your grace is enough for me. the heavens rejoice, let the earth be glad, let the people of God sing His praise all over the land. Everyone in the valley, come and lift your voice. All those on the mountaintop, be glad, shout for joy. Rise up and praise. Let the heavens rejoice, let the earth be glad, let the people of God sing and praise all over the land. Everyone in the valley, come and lift your voice. All those on the mountaintop, be glad, shout for joy. Rise up and praise. Son of thy love, for Jesus, you died. days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And these are the days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sore. Still are the days of the harvest. The fields are as wide in your word. And these are the labors in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the cloud, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, there's no God like Jehovah, 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 there's no God like Jehovah.
Good to see you here this morning. Another great day God's given to us to enjoy together. Just want to highlight a couple of announcements, draw your attention, some things to pray about. Out of the Information Center, we have a sign-up sheet for December 5th in 4 weeks, looking to have a soup and bread luncheon. For any of you who'd like to attend, just opportunity to get together and fellowship. We would like you to sign up if you're planning on coming. And then if you want to bring soup, make sure it's in a large crock pot, whatever soup you like to bring. And as we've done in the past with our luncheons like this, there's going to be a best soup competition, okay? So we want to give away some great rewards for that. So if you want to be a part of that, sign up at the information desk before you leave. We'd appreciate it. Continue to pray for those with COVID or recovering from COVID. We still have a couple of folks with it, Ken Jackson in particular, It's been about 10 days, and he has not recovered fully from that yet. Still struggling, so pray for Ken. We have those who are recovering, and then we have folks that are staying away because they just want to be careful with that, some of older folks, younger folks. So just keep those things in prayer, if you would. Pray for Scott Stewart and the family. They are at a funeral this morning for Scott's nephew, Ryan Stewart, who passed away this week. Not only just pray for them as a family, but pray for specifically for Scott, as he is going to be doing the funeral service for Ryan. Ryan was a believer. Matter of fact, about a year or so ago, Scott had the opportunity to baptize Ryan. So, but just pray for the family and their loss. And also others who are just struggling and dealing with physical issues, I would appreciate that. If my voice sounds weird today, it's better than it has been. But I was telling some folks I had an allergic reaction to medication from surgery a week ago. I had it on Thursday night, and Friday woke up looking like a Cro-Magnon man. I was just swelled and everything. So I'm on 3 antihistamines and 2 steroids and a bunch of other stuff. So I'm really not responsible for anything I say or do this morning. So, but of course, the allergies and all that stuff is getting to you. So we appreciate you folks being here. And of course, this past Thursday was an opportunity to remember our veterans, day to honor them. And what we try to do either the Sunday before or after, or if it's on there, is just kind of recognize our veterans that are here and to honor them. And if you are a veteran here this morning, I'm going to ask you to do 2 things. If you'd stand and then make your way up to the front. If you would do that now, please, if you're a veteran of any of the military branches that you served in, don't be shy and bashful. Take a stand coming up to the front. We want to honor you, recognize you, give you the microphone, give you opportunity to talk about who you are. I know there's more than just Jim, so come on, Jim. Any other veterans? Okay, there's John. Any others? Curtis. All right. We'll let Curtis have a seat. Okay. I'll take this one microphone to Curtis, but I'll leave this one up here. If you guys would introduce yourselves, let us know who you are, your name, what branch of the military you served in, what years you served, and anything else interesting you'd like to share with us about your military service. John, start with you.
John Haliba, U.S. Army, 20 years in the military, retired from there. Most of my tours were over in the desert, Alaska, basically, not too many before. That's about it. Did 20 years for it.
Is he ready to go? For those of you who know me, I'm Jim Rankin, Gary's brother. I have to introduce myself. As I say Jim Rankin, they always say, "Are you Gary's brother?" So that's my new name. I'm Jim Rankin, Gary's brother. I actually signed my name that way now. I served in the Marines for 20 years. Thank you. I would be remiss if we didn't also take time to recognize all the wives and mothers of vets, because I traveled all over the world. My wife ended up raising our girls by herself and holding down the home front, and it was it's just as hard for her, not knowing where in the world I was or what I was up to, because sometimes she couldn't know. I worked intelligence, and that's an oxymoron, Marine Corps intelligence. Like black light, icy hot, those are morons. I mean, they're, you know what they are. So anyways, but my wife, I always salute her, because she's a real hero of my family and ours. So thank you. Have a great day.
Curtis McCain, the Air Force. He was Strategic Air Command, 5 years.
Thank you, gentlemen. Appreciate that so much. Let's just pause and pray, shall we? Father, thank you this morning for the opportunity to be here together. Thank you for these individuals, these men who are with us this morning, who served in a branch of the military, who were willing to dedicate and sacrifice their life for the freedoms that we enjoy. We'd not only thank you for them and honor them, I agree with Jim that we also are thankful for the wives and mothers who took care of children and took care of families while these men were away serving. And Father, we not only thank you for these men, but for all those across the country who have served faithfully and dedicated themselves to what makes this country great. And we thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning is a time of remembrance, remembering those that who served in the military, but also remembering the Lord's death, burial, and resurrection through communion. And then when we open God's Word in a few moments after that, we're going to be remembering some important things that we need to be living out before the world. If you want to take your Bibles, if you would, as we prepare for communion, the Lord's table. Turn to Luke chapter 22. Luke chapter 22, and I'm going to start reading at verse 14. If you could follow along in your Bibles as I do, I'd appreciate that. Verse 14 of Luke 22. And when the hour came, he reclined at the table, and the apostles with him. And he said to them, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat of it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, take this, and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And likewise the cup after they had eaten, saying, this cup is being poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. But behold, the hand of him who betrays me is with me at the table. For the Son of Man goes that it has been determined, but woe to that man by whom he is betrayed. And they began to question one another, which of them it would be that was going to do this. On this particular occasion, Christ is with his disciples and they're having the Last Supper, and he gives them some specific commands about how they are to remember what Christ was going to do in just a few short hours. And they are things for us to remember, that this is my body which is given for you. This is my blood which is shed for you. The great sacrifice that Christ gave for us, because we needed that, right? We could not save ourselves. We needed someone like Christ, a sinless, perfect sacrifice, to die on the cross for our sins and to shed his blood and to suffer all he did on his body for us. So that we, by faith in that, can have a restored relationship with God as we were originally created to have. We have communion regularly, at least once a month, just as a reminder of Christ's sacrifice for us. And as we prepare for that this morning, I'm going to ask Pastor Kenny to come. He and I are going to serve you this morning. But as he comes, let's just spend a few moments in quiet reflection and prayer. Scripture does instruct us to do that, just thinking about what we are partaking of, what we're going to be doing here, and remembering what Christ did for you all those years ago so that you could have a relationship with God by faith. So let's pray quietly, and then in just a few moments we'll begin. I'll give you some further instructions. Father, as we participate in this morning, as we remember your great sacrifice on our behalf, the fact that your body was given for us as our substitute. When we should have paid the price for our own sins, you took that upon yourself. And Father, we remember that with the bread that is broken. And then when we take the cup and we share together in the juice, it reminds us that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. And we thank you that Christ shed his blood for us, so that by faith, trusting in that sacrifice, our relationship with you is restored. And we thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. As we've done the last several months, we're going to ask you to be dismissed from the back, starting on the back rows. If you'll make your way up the middle, Kenny and I will serve you. Once you've received your bread and taken the cup, you can make your way back to the outside to your row. Then once you're seated, wait for everyone to be done. Then when everyone has received their elements, we'll share in these things together, because that also is the instruction of the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians, that we do it together as a sign of the unity we have in Christ. So let's start from the back. If you make your way up the front, let's share in this time together. Thank you. likewise, after the cup they had eaten, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is a new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." As I mentioned just a little bit ago, communion is a regular opportunity for us to refocus our lives on the vertical. You may be asking yourself, well, what does that mean? Well, last week we started looking at vertical thinking and asking ourselves the question, what is vertical thinking? And trying to understand what that is from a scriptural standpoint. And when we looked at that, we looked at a passage in the Old Testament, but we also looked at the New Testament. And I want you to turn to Matthew chapter 6. If you turn to Matthew 6, we want to read this. Last week, we kind of touched on Matthew 6. We looked in 2 Chronicles. And this morning, what I want to do is go back into those passages and continue to unpack them and to look at them so we can really deepen our understanding of what does it mean to be a vertical thinker. So Matthew chapter 6 is what we're going to look at. I'm going to read the entire chapter so we can understand what's going on. As I said, Matthew chapter 6 is in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount, Christ's great teaching. And there are some important things that will help us in here to understand what does it mean to be a vertical thinker. Beware practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them. For then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. Thus, when you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and in the street corners, that they may be seen of others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you go to pray, into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask. Pray then like this: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespass, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. And when you fast, do not be gloomy like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces with their fasting, so that they may be seen by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face, that your fasting may not be seen by others, but your heavenly Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. So if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light in you is darkness, how is this darkness? No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. Therefore, I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. And you and of you are more valuable than they. And which of you, being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like these. But if God so clothed the grass of the field, which is today alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat, what shall we drink, what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious in itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. We started last week by looking at Matthew 6:33. In the context of what's going on in Matthew, it says, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you." And we began to look and develop the fact that seeking the kingdom of God is vertical thinking. Seeking the things of the world is more of a horizontal thinking. And we need to get into the understanding of we need to be vertical thinkers instead of horizontal thinkers, thinking about the kingdom, not just about all these things. Now, I want to clarify what is meant by the kingdom of God and his righteousness and all these things, just so we can get on the same page, so we understand what we're talking about when somebody says, seek first the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God, generally speaking, is God's sovereign rule over all of creation from the beginning of time until the end. If you were to go online and type in the kingdom of God, what is it? You'd have similar graphs like this, but this kind of divides Old and New Testament. But really, it's God's rule and reign in Israel and God's rule and reign in the church. But it really encompasses everything from the beginning of creation until the end. That's God's kingdom. But basically, what it means is this. Simply put, we are to seek the things that are a priority to God as a priority in our own life, not the things that make up life. We are to seek the things that are a priority to God as a priority of our life. That's seeking first the kingdom of God. Now, things that are priority to God that we've been instructed with, sharing the gospel, living obedient lives, honoring God in how we live and interact with people. It's approaching every situation in life with this type of a thought. God, is this a priority to you? Is this something that will advance your kingdom? How should I think about this situation that I'm in? So no matter what you are confronted with in life, all your thoughts always go first of all to the kingdom. Is this going to be something to advance the kingdom, honor God, be obedient to what he's instructed me? That's always to be our first thought. That's vertical thinking. That's the kingdom first, not all these things. Now, it's not that all the things that make up life, food, clothing, shelter, friends, work, family, are not important. Jesus is not saying that. But if you're a follower of Jesus by faith, we're to have a different attitude towards all those things. If we are taking care of God's business as a priority, he is going to take care of our business just as he's promised, okay? That's kind of what it says. Seek first God's priorities, and he will take care of your priorities. That's what he's promised to do, and this passage develops that as we go through it. So that's kind of what kingdom thinking is, and that's kind of what seeking first the kingdom of vertical thinking is. It is setting God's priorities first in my life. That's always my first thought. Kingdom, not all the other things that are in life. Now, we also looked at Hezekiah, this young king at age 25 that took over the rule of Judah in 2 Chronicles 29 through 32, and we looked at some things that he did. We looked at the fact that he restored the temple, repaired the doors, he cleansed the temple, got all the idols of Baal out, He organized the priests again to be able to serve in the temple. He restored worship. He restored the Passover, which was the highest festival that the Jews had to celebrate. Now, the question I ask is, why did Hezekiah do these things immediately when he became king? It says in 2 Chronicles 29 that in the first month of the first year of his reign, he got after this. Now, why did he do that? He did it because of the importance of the temple in Jewish life. The importance of the temple in Jewish life. Now, Israel was to be a theocracy. It was to be a monotheistic people, not a polytheistic people. Now, big words, Sunday morning, what do they mean? Well, theocracy basically means theo is the word for God. So theocracy means God was to be their king, okay? And of course, they ran into trouble when they said, God, we want to be like everybody else. They all have earthly kings. We want that. And God's like, okay. And those earthly kings caused them nothing but trouble. But they were designed to be a theocracy. Now, monotheistic basically means one God. Polytheistic means many, or pantheistic, okay? So they were to be a nation that followed the one true God, not like the rest of the nations around them. And the temple was to be the focal point of that. If they were going to be the people of God that followed God, that understood that they were to be a people of one God, God established this system where the temple would represent his presence on earth. And their whole Jewish life revolved around the temple. This is an artist's depiction of the first temple that was built, Solomon's temple. And it was also designed in such a way, as you look at that, and hopefully you can read it, but the outer courts, they had what was called the court of the Gentiles. So if you came to Jerusalem and you were not a Jewish person, you still had the opportunity to go to the temple. You would hang around in the court of the Gentiles. Then they had the court of Israel. If you were a Jew, you could hang around in there. Some people called that the court of the women. Now, the other court, if you see to the left side in the square there, says the court of the men of Israel. This is where the Jewish men would go and gather. And then inside you have the actual temple proper where they would bring their sacrifices on a daily basis. And this was to be the center of life. Everything revolved around that. Now, they should have understood this because when the Israelites were in the wilderness wandering for 40 years, every time they camped out and stopped and spent a period of time somewhere, they would camp themselves out in the structure the way God had designed, and the tabernacle, the temple, was right in the middle. So everything revolved around that. So the temple was the center of Jewish life, and because the previous kings before Hezekiah had kind of taken them away from that and followed Baal and all the other gods, the pantheistic gods of the area, Israel had lost their focus on vertical thinking. They'd lost their focus on the kingdom first, because all the other gods and the nations around were always worried about the crops and the rain and the sun and all these things. See, the temple, the sacrificial system, the Passover, were all established to daily, weekly, monthly, and yearly remind Israel of the need for vertical thinking. God first, kingdom first. That's why Hezekiah had to do all those things he did in the very first year of his reign to get people's focus back again to where it needed to be. Now, I know the church is not Israel, okay? There are clear distinctions between the church and Israel, but in one comparison, the church is a weekly reminder for us to be thinking about, learning about God's priorities and how to live them out. That's why we gather together, right? And it's this weekly reminder whenever you come. Whenever you think about it, oh, Sunday is coming, I need to get ready for church. I need to be there. Why? Because it helps remind you I need to be about the kingdom first, not all the other stuff of life that seems to creep in through the rest of the week. So kingdom of God first, all these other things. That's why Hezekiah had to reestablish and get the temple back where it needed to be so Israel could get back to where they needed to be. And the same thing for why you're here as well. Now, in Matthew 6, we just read that passage, and Matthew 6 has four examples of areas in our life where we can very easily get messed up between the vertical and horizontal thinking. We touched on them a little bit at the end of last week. I want to go back and kind of revisit them a little bit, continuing to, like I said, unpack them, make sure on the same page as what we're trying to understand. Now, Jesus teaches these things to remind us how easy it can be to lose our focus. It is easy. I get that. I understand that. It's easy for us when life comes in, we get focused on this, you know. When physical troubles come and spiritual battles and financial issues and we lose our focus on God first and we get hung up on those things. So it's very easy to lose that reminder. That's why Jesus taught this, to remind not only his hearers but also us of how easy it is for us to get it mixed up. Now, I'll go through this list again. Generosity and fasting. It says at the beginning there that... But when you give to the needy, do not let your right hand know what the left hand is doing. This is not just giving of their tithe. This is beyond that. This is where something that giving alms, A-L-M-S, which was kind of giving to the poor, was something that the Jews were instructed to do. It was one of God's priorities. And it says, when you give, don't let you know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be done in secret. Also goes on to say, when you fast, fasting was another one of these things that is still encouraged by us. Fasting is basically giving up some of these things so that we can focus on the kingdom. Giving up some of all these things so we can focus more upon God. Maybe giving up a meal, maybe giving up a couple of meals, maybe giving up a whole day of not eating, maybe giving up watching TV for an hour, maybe putting your phone locked away in your room somewhere and not touching it for a day. How do we do that, right? I mean, that's one of those things, all these things. I mean, no sooner you open your eyes, you grab for your phone and you press the button, right? What's going on in the world? Whereas their first thought should be, God, what is today's priority for me? And maybe that's what fasting is, but fasting was something I was supposed to do. And it goes on to say, don't be like the hypocrites who go out into the street and basically look all disfigured and gloomy, like, oh, I'm fasting for Jesus, you know. Don't do that. In other words, you'll get your reward simply by people saying, oh, okay, I see you're doing that. But when you fast, anoint your head, wash your face, that your fasting may not be seen by others, but your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Now, the reason Jesus talks about this is one of these ways where when we give and we do things for God, are we doing it for the right reason, the right motivation? Are we focusing on the kingdom or on other things in ourselves? I remember the story, and you probably do, about the Pharisee and the tax collector in Luke chapter 18. The Pharisee comes in and the tax collector comes in. The Pharisee goes up to the front and stands, and the tax collector goes to the back and kneels and tries to hide himself. And the Pharisee stands and raises his arms to heaven and says, Lord, I thank you. I'm not like other men, especially this tax collector. I give and I tithe and I do this and I do this. But the tax collector said, God, I'm not worthy to even be here. And Jesus finishes up by saying, who's more righteous, right? See, if you do something to be seen by others, basically when we draw attention to ourselves when doing things that are a priority to God, and this kind of giving was their priority, it's no longer about him. It's about you. So you've taken something that's God's priority and you've made it about you. You've robbed him of his glory in that. And now we're stuck in this horizontal thing. I want it to be all about me. It's very easy for us to do that. To brag about what we've given to God, how many years we've served God, things we've done, and we get into those conversations, and really what we're doing is trying to draw attention to ourselves, and that's horizontal thinking. Vertical thinking is, they don't need to know. They don't need to know what you've done, how much you've given, who you've helped, okay? You do it because it's God's priority. That's the only reason you should. Kingdom of God or all these things. So generosity and fasting, the way Jesus taught, is a reminder that pride, self, ego can very easily get in the way. A matter of fact, if you were to go back to 2 Chronicles chapter 31, you'd find out that even Hezekiah ran into trouble. Hezekiah was sick. He prayed to God to heal him. God healed him. But he did not honor God in the healing. He thought it was all about him. Scripture says that he became very proud. And God said, okay, because of your pride, judgment's going to come. And then he humbled himself and prayed and asked for God's forgiveness, and God withheld that. So it's very easy, even Hezekiah, with all the focus on kingdom first, it was very easy for him to slip and to become self-focused, horizontally thinking. So, next thing is prayer. When you pray, how do you pray? What's the first thing that you say or do? Now, most people say, well, when I pray, you probably start up by saying God, Father, or something like that. But what are your prayers like? What is the pattern of your prayer? God, I need, right? Usually, our first response to God in prayer is, God, I'm coming to you because I need. That type of a thinking or a statement is horizontal. It's all about these things. God, I have a need physically, spiritually, whatever, and we jump right into that. That's why when the disciples said, well, Jesus, how do we pray? He said, you pray like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Jesus taught them that when you pray, your first thought is to be kingdom first. Vertical thinking. Matter of fact, you ask these type of questions again during prayer. God, is this a priority for you? Is this something that you will advance your kingdom? How should I respond to this? You're thinking about what God would want you to do. That's vertical thinking. We've talked about Philippians 4, 8 and 9. Whatever things are true, honest, just, lovely, of good report. If there's any value in those, think on these things. In other words, thinking about what's going to honor God. So if you have a situation in your life that you're dealing with, your first response is you go to God and say, God, you are the God of creation. You are the God of heaven. You are all-knowing, all-powerful, and you just begin to praise him for who he is. That's vertical thinking. That's what Jesus was talking about. That's how you start to pray. So that when you get to the stuff of all these things, all the stuff of life, jobs, finances, kids, relationships, all those things, your question is not God I, but God you. What do you want to do in this situation? How do you want me to handle this? How is this situation going to bring you glory? What can I do, God, so that you'll be honored through this? Everything revolves around the vertical thinking. Kingdom first, not all these things. And it's very easy for us to slip up with that. It's also very easy for us, he said in that passage, don't go into vain repetitions like the Gentiles or the heathens do. I don't know about you, but when you pray before a meal, how many of you have the same prayer that you pray every single time? Come on, be honest now. Okay, you got Debbie, thank you for being honest. All right, appreciate that. Everyone else is kidding himself. I do that. I fall into those patterns. And it comes time to pray. Lord, thank you for today. Thank you for the food. Amen, right? And it's not that I don't mean it, but it's just this repetition. And then Denise, the loving, insightful wife that she is, after I get done saying that, she says, could you think you could pray something different next time? And I'm like, what are you talking about? She's like, you say that too often. Think of something new. And it's very easy for us to fall into those ruts and those patterns of just rattling it off. Not that we're not sincere or genuine, but are we really putting the thought into what we're saying? Not only what we're saying, but who we're saying it to, right? That's why Jesus said, you pray like this, our Father who art in heaven. Think about who you're praying to. That's a part of vertical thinking as well. So, the next thing, praying is the way, as Jesus taught, is a reminder that life is about God's will being done, not mine. That's what we've got to get stuck into, that thing. So, generosity and fasting, prayer. Now he talks about money. And I spent a little bit of time last week about that, and I know some people get really upset and squirrely when you talk about money, and you know, you're always, as I mentioned, usually every 3 or 4 years for about 3 weeks we talk about money, and that's about it. But if you get upset with the fact that I talk about money, that really speaks more about your attitude to your money than it does about what I'm saying, really. It talks about the fact that you don't understand what God says about money, and you don't want to understand what God says about money. It says this, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also, right? Basically what Jesus is saying this, what you value, you'll invest in. What you value, you will invest in. If you value you, you'll invest in you. If you value the kingdom, you'll invest in the kingdom. It's that simple. If you're a vertical thinker and you're thinking about the kingdom and God's priorities, you're not going to look at your money as it's all about you. You're going to look at it, it's all about God, right? Says there, no one can serve two masters, for either you will hate the one or love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. It can't be both. You can't be half vertical, half horizontal. You can't be stuck in the middle. It's got to be one or the other. It's either what is of value to you. Giving and tithing is a regular reminder that all we have is from God and we're simply stewards. Every time that money is given and that tithe is given, it's a tangible reminder. God, everything is from you, and I'm giving back a portion of that to you so that I remember it's yours. It's not that God needs to know it's his, so that I know, God, this is yours. And I remember that every time I give. And that's really where we can get messed up, right? Kingdom of God are all these things. Then the last thing about food and clothing at the end of the passage there, and really says, do not be like them, these are the unbelievers, for your Father knows what you want before you ask for him. No? Okay. Knows what you what? Need. Therefore, do not say, be anxious, saying, what shall we eat, what shall we drink, what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after these things, and your Heavenly Father knows what you need, right? Matter of fact, Philippians 4:19 says, and my God will supply every need according to your riches and glory. Every need. Need. Clarify, what's a need? A need are things to sustain life. Food, clothing, shelter, a job to earn money to provide those things, right? They're needs. Anything beyond the things that sustain life are usually wants. Now, is there something wrong with wanting new things, nicer things? No. But what's your priority, right? If you're constantly worried about all those things, you know, not just food, clothing, shelter, but you want the better job and more money and bigger house and nicer car, and, you know, I want that. And we also confuse that because we say, God, I need this. No, you don't. Now, it's nice to have, but if you don't have it, that's okay. But you still have food in your house, and you still have a roof over your head and clothes to wear. God has provided those, but he knows your needs. Focusing on need instead of want reminds us that God will take care of us as he has promised, right? But too often we get that kind of messed up again. It's very easy. Well, God, I need this. No, you don't need an iPhone 11 with the best camera ever created. Would it be nice to have? Absolutely. But you can still get by with your flip phone. Okay? Matter of fact, I think Samsung brought back the flip phone, didn't they? Yeah. I mean, you know, but we think about these things. We need the newest and latest and best. But no, we want it, but not necessarily do we need it. One of the things that really freaks me out is, you know, people say, well, we need a vacation. Okay. So they take their family to Disney World and pay for it on a credit card. I'm like, yeah, that's not good, right? What have you just done? You've used God's money in a way to get what you want, right? If you want to go on vacation, I think that's great. Go on vacation. But as a wise money manager, what should you do first? Save for that vacation, right? That's just one of those things. And I hear so many families that do that. They go all these extravagant places on vacation. Now, we've been to Florida a lot, and we've been over to Australia a lot, of course. But you know what? I'm cheap. I go stay with family, right? We have family in Florida, so hey, right? I'm not going to Disney World. I'll go to Florida, right? They have a pool. I'll swim in their pool. We go to Australia. What do? I stay with family. I say, well, you can. Hey, if you want to come to Australia with me, you can stay with my family. I don't care, right? But it's one of those things where it's not going to be you save for what you need to do. That's just a part of wise things. But we say, well, I need this, but it's not really a need, it's a want. Right? But focusing on our needs, simply those things that sustain life, helps us remind us God is going to take care of us. And it's very interesting how these things work together. If we're stuck on these things, the food, clothing, shelter, stuff, wants, our money is going to follow that. Why? Because where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. If you value all of that stuff over the kingdom, that's where your money is going to go. And then what are you going to be praying about? You're going to be praying about wanting those things. And then you're not going to be generous. You're not going to be something to give because you're not going to have anything to give. And the reverse of that is very simple. If you are kingdom-focused and you are kingdom-first, vertical thinking, you're going to be generous. You're going to be praying, what do you want done here, God? What is going to glorify you, advance the kingdom? You're going to take that money God has given you and invest it in the kingdom, and you're going to be satisfied with and content with the food, clothing, and shelter, the basic needs of life. Next week, we're going to talk about gratitude. As it relates to vertical thinking. And gratitude is one of those things that we have a hard time with. We're not grateful for what we have. We're always looking for something else. And we'll see how that ties in as well. So vertical thinking is a daily, regular, biblical reminders to help us focus our lives on the vertical. But it's very easy to get those things messed up, okay? So we need to be careful of that and ask those important questions. Are we seeking the kingdom first, God's priorities, or our own priorities? If we're seeking our own, that's not vertical, that's horizontal. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. So I hope this morning, as we've kind of continued on from last week and added and expanded and grown a little bit, that your thinking has beginning to change, a better understanding of what it means to think vertically. And next week we'll continue on with that again. Let's pray. Father, thank you this morning for the opportunity to come, to gather, to be able to listen and understand your word. Help us to be people that develop the right type of thinking. Kingdom first, not other things. And we'll thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise team's going to come lead us in a couple of songs. Just want to remind you about this. When they are done with the two songs, we don't want you to be dismissed. We'd like you to have a seat. Stan has an announcement he'd like to share with you from the elder board. And so that'll take a few minutes. So after we've done singing, don't leave. Stay in your seats. Stan will dismiss you after his announcement. But let's stand now and sing.
You call me out upon the waters, the great unknown. Feet may fail, and there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand, and I will call upon your name, and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours and you are Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith would be made stronger. Above the waves, when oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Oh, and you are mine, oh. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one. name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live.
Seated.